Hi friends, welcome to Everstudy Classes. So in the previous video, we discussed how the past year papers, they are very important for the upcoming examination. So we discussed what should be the right approach of covering those past year questions, and we learned that we should focus on conceptual and factual clarity and not just marking the right answer. So in this direction, we have started this series that is Blast from the Past 5 MCQ series. So in this particular series, we are going to regularly pick up 5 MCQs from the different units one by one. That is, for example, in this particular video, we have picked up this unit of banking and financial institutions. And we are going to take up 5 important questions which have been asked in the past. And we are going to discuss those in broader framework in conceptual terms. So this is going to be our agenda, our strategy for covering this particular past year papers. So this particular video, let's start with our discussion on the past questions on banking and financial institutions unit. So friends, before moving forward, let me quickly tell you about the courses which we are presently running for UGC NET Commerce Examination. So these are the free courses which we are presently running on our website, that is www.everstudy.co.in. So these are the courses. First one is with regard to the past year papers, and this particular video will also be posted in this particular course. Now in this course, we are trying to analyze the importance of past year papers. We are going to cover the questions which are asked in the previous year papers in a very conceptual manner in order to make sure that if these questions, they are repeated, we are able to get them right. We have already posted the past year papers for last 10 years with regard to UGC Net Commerce, and we have already posted this video of how to approach the previous year papers. So you can freely access those videos by subscribing to this particular course. And also we have this free course of unit-wise glossary in which we are covering all the important terms associated with this unit in a very short and crisp manner. And we are also providing some practice MCQs after you complete this reading of glossary. And also we have recently launched the test series for UGC Net Commerce Examination 2018. Now we have two options from which you can choose. First one is a full length mock test series in which we are giving 6 full length mocks at $499. And these will be full length mocks in itself, and they will comprise all the units of the syllabus. And these will be very similar to the type of examination paper that you will be getting. And the main feature is that you are going to get the real exam like experience. So friends, as you might be aware that from this particular attempt, this UGC Net Commerce and the UGC Net Examination in general has been made a computer based test. So you would have to give this test on computer. So we have tried to simulate the entire platform which will be there in the actual examination so that you can practice giving test on this particular platform, so that when ultimately the time comes to appear in the main examination, then you are very much aware, very much well versed with the pattern, how this look and feel of this particular scenario, so that it becomes a more of a friendly scenario for you. Also, we have a full length test series, a complete test series in which we are giving 12 sectional tests, and each test will have 100 questions each from the different units which are there in the course. And we are also going to have 6 full length mock tests, and the same features they are going to apply to this particular test series also. So let's start with the first question for this particular video. So there is this question: match the following items of list 1 with the items of list 2 and indicate the code of correct matching. So here we have two lists which are given. We are given the different sorts of organizations like IDBI, ICICI, LIC of India and SIDBI, and we are also given the year of establishments of these organizations, though not in the correct order. So we have to arrange this in a correct order, or in a way we have to match these particular items. So friends, in order to answer this particular question, one approach could have been just to mark the right answer that, okay, this was in 1964, this was in this year, this was in this year. But we are not following that particular approach because this one is a very narrow approach and we are going to follow a broad-based approach. So here, we are going to cover these important institutions which have been asked in this question in a much more detail. So first, let's look at IDBI, that is Industrial Development Bank of India. Now this particular IDBI institution, it was constituted on 1st July 1964. So this was constituted in 1964. This is a very old institution. And If you talk about the constitution of this IDBI, it was constituted under a separate act. There was this IDBI Act 1964. A separate law was introduced in order to make sure this IDBI comes into picture. And this IDBI was set up to provide direct and indirect finance. So the purpose was that we have to provide the money to industry so that they can develop, the India can grow. And that's why this institution was set up. So it was regarded as a public financial institution. So it was decided that it was going to be a public financial institution and it is going to provide finance to the public. And it continued to serve as this financial institution for 40 years. So it continued to serve these purposes for 40 years and was formally transformed into a bank on 28th September 2004. So this is also important that when did IDBI become a bank? It became a bank on 28th September 2004. IDBI Bank was earlier known as IDBI Limited and its name was changed to IDBI Bank Limited on 7th of May 2018. So the important years with regard to IDBI would be 1964, the birth of IDBI, 2004 when it became a bank, and 2008 when it became IDBI Bank Limited. Next is ICICI, that is Industrial Credit and Investment Corporation of India. So this one is also a very old one. It was established in 1955 as a public limited company under the Indian Companies Act. So this institution ICICI, it was set up to provide for development of medium and small industries of the private sector. So in order to boost the setting up of medium and small industries in the private sector, this particular corporation was established in order to provide the necessary facilities, necessary financing for setting up these kinds of businesses. In March 2002, the ICICI was merged with ICICI Bank. So in 1955, born, 2002, merged with ICICI Bank. Next is Life Insurance Corporation of India or LIC. Now LIC, we are all aware of that it is a insurance company, it is also an investment company owned by the government and it was founded in 1956. So this one is also a very old one, founded in 1956, and for this particular purpose a separate law was passed by the parliament, it is Life Insurance of India Act, and this particular law was introduced to nationalize the private insurance industry in India. So earlier there were lots of private insurers, but now the government felt the need that it should regulate this particular sector in order to make sure that the people are taking the right benefits out of this life insurance. It went for nationalization and as a result this LIC was formed in 1956. Next is SIDB, that is Small Industries Development Bank of India. Now this name itself indicates this one is going to cater to the small industries. So this caters to micro, small and medium MSME sector in India. So it is catering to MSME sector in India and it was established on April 2, 1990. So this is an old one but not as old as the other three. So it was set up as a statutory body through a separate act of parliament on 2nd of April 1990. So friends, now we can easily solve this question that this particular matching can be rightly done now that we know SIDB was formed in 1990, we know about IDBI that it was formed in 1964, we know about ICICI in 1955 and then again we know about LIC in 1956. So now we can easily match that A is going to be 4, we know B is going to be 2nd, we know C is going to be 1st and D is going to be 3. So the right answer is option number 3 here. Next question is statement 1 and statement 2 they are given, and the statement first reads, capital adequacy norms help banks in strengthening their capital base. Statement 2 reads, capital adequacy norms help banks in sanctioning more loans. And we are being asked whether both are correct or only one of these statements it is correct. So to answer this particular question, we must be aware about the capital adequacy norms. And whenever we talk about the capital adequacy norm, we simply jump on to capital adequacy ratio. So this capital adequacy ratio is required to be maintained by the banks. And this ratio is computed as the ratio of capital to risk weight assets of the bank. So on the one side, we take the capital of the bank, the funds of the bank, and on the other side, we take the different scenarios, we take the different areas in which the bank has put its money, and we do not simply take those areas, we try to assign them weights in proportion to the risk attached to all these assets, and we find the risk weighted assets. So we compare these two and we try to compare that whether we are having adequate capital in relation to the risks which are attached to the assets of the bank. So this becomes the capital adequacy ratio. So if this ratio is higher, it means we are having more capital for the risk weighted assets. This means that there is more protection of the depositors of the bank and it paves way for more financial stability. So this ratio, it is used by the central banks like RBI in India and other regulators to put a check on commercial banks. This check is put on commercial banks that they maintain proper capital as compared to their assets, so that they do not involve themselves in giving excess loans and they ultimately result in losses for them. So this is to prevent excessive leverage, this is to prevent that they do not give excess amount of loans as compared to the capital they are having. So if we talk about in formula terms, this is measured as capital adequacy ratio is equal to tier 1 plus tier 2, and there may be also a third tier which can be in case of Basel 3 norms, and this one is divided by the risk weighted assets. And why this capital we have divided into different tiers? Because this tier 1 capital is the core capital of the bank, like the equity one. And the tier 2 capital is not the pure capital, the other capital which is left out would be coming in this tier 2 capital, and this would be a subordinate capital. And the Basel norms, these are very important. So we may be asked this, that Basel norms they are associated with. So we have to remember that the Basel norms, they talk about the proper capital adequacy ratio. They specify what should be the ideal ratio to be maintained by the banks worldwide. So friends, now we can easily answer this question, that the first statement which says that this norms, they help banks in strengthening their capital base, is going to be a correct statement. But the second statement, that these norms help bank in giving more loans, this is going to be incorrect, because these norms, they ensure that the banks do not give excess amount of loans in comparison to their capital. So the answer is going to be statement 1 is correct, but 2 is incorrect. So 3 is going to be the answer. Next question, which of the following are the forms of e-banking? And we have to select the correct code. So here the different forms they are given are internet banking, telephone banking, electronic check conversion, electronic bill payment, direct fund transfer through RTGS. Now this question is a very simple one. If you are reading just now, then you will find that this one is very easy. But what happens in the examination, what people generally do, they try to find some loopholes in this particular question. They try to find some, do some thinking which is different from the thinking which is required for solving this question. And they fail to take a broad view of the term e-banking. So for example, they just stick to doing transactions on computer to just, they just mean that this is e-banking. But they have to remember that e-banking is electronic banking, and this e-banking is a very vast term. So in light of this, let's look at this meaning of this term. So e-banking is the process of delivery of banking services and products, not just through computer, not just through online. It is through electronic channels, which can be even telephone, it can be internet, or it can even be cell phone. So there can be different channels through which this banking can be provided, and then this would become as e-banking. So this one provides you fast, easy, and efficient access to your bank account, and you can carry out the banking transactions 24/7. Now there are different forms of e-banking. So they include the ATM. I believe you all must be using this particular ATM thing. And then there is internet banking, which is also very simple, that you can simply transfer the funds using internet. And then there is telephone banking, on which you can simply do the transactions telephonically, and you can convey the required instructions to the bank for them. And then there is electronic funds transfer, which includes NEFT, RTGS, etc. Then there is credit card and debit card, which is also very simple and very common. And then there is a system of electronic checks, and now there is no need for sending physical checks. You can simply provide a digital copy or electronic check so that the transactions can be processed. Also, there are sort of system for smart cards, and these are very similar to what you get in Big Bazaar type stores. And then there is electronic bill payment system, so you can easily make all your utility bill payments like mobile phone bill or the electricity bill using this particular systems. And this one also is a form of e-banking. So we have to take a very broad view of the term e-banking. So if we take a broad view of this particular term e-banking, then this would become very easy for us. So the correct answer is going to be option number 4, that is all of the above, they are the forms of e-banking. So now let's move to the next question. So this, it is an assertion reasoning question, but it is a very easy one. So assertion is that the future will see mostly the electronic money clearance through satellite networking. Reasoning is RBI is encouraging e-banking. So in these types of questions, there is a statement given and there is a reason for why this statement should be true. This reason is given and we have to find out whether these statements they are true and whether this reason it is correctly relating to the statement made. So in this particular case, we are being told that in future there will be electronic money clearance and this will involve the use of satellite networks. Now this is true because the new electronic money clearance systems, the e-banking, they are all based on networks only. So this is going to be true. And the reason is that RBI is encouraging e-banking. So this one is also true that RBI is encouraging e-banking. But are the two related to each other? Whether R is the reason of A? So if you just try to understand that if the RBI tries to promote e-banking, it will lead to the future seeing electronic money clearance systems. So if this R is true, it would definitely lead to A. So here both are going to be true and the R is going to be the correct explanation of A. So this is the correct answer, option number 3. So now let's move on to the next question, which is what is hawala. So this is also a very important question asked in the examination. So options are tax evasion, illegal trading in stock exchanges, bank robbery, illegal transactions of foreign exchange. Now you all might have heard about this term hawala, so let me quickly just tell you the summary of this particular term. So in hawala, money is transferred without any actual movement. So at its basic premise, it is just undocumented transfer of money. For example, there is this person in Dubai. So this person has to send money to Smita in Kerala. So either it can follow all the legal rules, the digital rules, and this would involve proper amount of regulatory procedures to be complied with, taxes to be paid, and other option can be that they involve the use of this hawala transaction. So this person in Dubai gets into touch with this hawala broker and this person gives this money to hawala broker, and this person has links in India and Kerala, and this person, it says to this person that okay, I have received this money from this Mr. Rajesh and this money is to be given to Smita, and this person, on its instructions, this person gives the money to Smita in Kerala. So this person is giving dollars to this broker in Dubai and this person in Kerala is giving rupees to this person Smita in Kerala. So this is how this whole transaction works. So it is also often referred to as underground banking because this system generally operates in an underground manner, in a secret manner. Now even though it is illegal and it is run by many dealers, many people trust this business due to different sorts of factors like family or religious affiliations. So now we can easily answer this question that hawala, it is a system related to illegal transactions of foreign exchange. So friends, this was all about our discussion on 5 important questions which we have picked from the past year papers for the financial institutions and banking unit. Thank you friends. If you like this video, please like the same on YouTube. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel and please share this video with your friends. If you have any query, you can mail us at hello@everstudy.in or you can even join us our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/everstudyclasses, and you can even follow us on Telegram at t.me/everstudy, and the links of all these, they are given in the description of this particular video.